as we began to talk about it at the beginning of this month, today is kind of the Sunday we've been building up to as far as a place we feel that God is leading us to as a church and who we want to become and kind of the idea of faith at home, that we want to become a faith at home church. And as we've been telling you about this, telling you about the privilege that we have today for Mark Holman, who is a, we'll call him a missionary to this movement, is going to come and share with us today and share a message with us today about this. As we've told you a little bit about Mark before, he's been in ministry for 20-plus years, been a champion for the Faith at Home movement for just as long. He's been a featured speaker for Focus on the Family as well as Willow Creek Association. But I know in getting a chance to know Mark even better, I can tell you the most important thing to him is that he is a husband, he's a father, and he sees his primary goal in life, his responsibility from God, is to make sure his home is a place where faith is nurtured and lived out. So he's going to come and share with us today. We're glad to have Mark with us.
Good morning, friends. It is great to be with you. It's my first time to this part of the United States. I haven't been up in this area before. And I've had a chance. I started in Phoenix and then from there to Indiana. My wife and I now currently live in Minnesota. We were 12 years in Minnesota, then we went 12 years out to California, and we just moved back to Minnesota. So we are glutton for punishment. And but I will tell you, now that I've been here, I think I'm just going to call my wife and say we're moving here. So it's pretty beautiful here. And tomorrow will be our 24th wedding anniversary. So we are pretty excited for that. So in other words, I'm going home tomorrow, one way or another. So I'm not missing that. We're going to take a special offering here later for that. No, I'm kidding. And So I bring you greetings from my wife, Maria, 24 years. I got a soon-to-be 19-year-old daughter. My daughter was born on Halloween. So we always decorate big around our house for Halloween. Her nickname is Boo and for Halloween, and she is a freshman at the University of Minnesota, which is to pursue nursing is what she's heading into. So if I don't get that covered first, that tells you a little bit about us. And we are missionaries. I'm a missionary to an incredible movement that God is leading called the Faith at Home Movement, which is spreading not only across the U.S., but I've had a chance to go into 9 different countries over just the last 5 years and see God at work spreading this movement, this message to churches and to households literally all across the world. And so I want to be clear as we start here today, Faith at Home is not my thing. Don't attach my name to it. Don't give me credit for it. I am just a missionary to this incredible movement that actually God is now calling you and your church to be a part of. And you don't even know what it is, but my prayer is that by the end of this message time, not only will you know what this movement is, but you will know specifically the role God wants you to play in this movement. So let's begin this time by just giving this time over to the Lord. Would you join me in prayer? Dear Lord, I just thank you for bringing us here together. There's no accident that we are all in this room together, and there's a message now, Lord, that you want me to bring to these people here. And I just pray, Lord, that this will be your words being spoken through me, that I'm just a messenger of this message. Because if these are my words that are being spoken, my words have no power or authority whatsoever. But when your Holy Spirit takes control and anoints the words, then this message can change lives. So, Lord, may this be about you and not about me. And may these words be the words you want spoken for such a time as this. So we commit this time to you now in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, we pray. And all God's people said, good. I'm expecting you to be Baptist today. So I would like some good amens and whatever we need out of you today. I've got good news and bad news for you today. How many of you, when you hear that there's good news and bad news, when someone says, I got both those, how many of you like to get the bad news out of the way first? Like when they tell you you got good news, yeah, I'm one of those, like, give me the bad news first. Here is our bad news. The bad news is based on the research that's coming in today. It says somewhere between, and I'm just going to give you the range rather than just quoting you one statistic, somewhere between 60 to 90% of the kids that are active in church programs today are going to walk away from their Christian faith. And that doesn't mean they're just going to quit going to church for a few years. No, they're actually walking away from Christianity altogether. They're going to disengage from it altogether. How many here don't like the sounds of that? And so it's like, and then it sets up a question of why. Why are these kids walking away from the faith? Well, as you read that research that's coming in, what always surfaces to the top is one thing, and that is hypocrisy. The reason they're walking away from Christianity is they think it's hypocritical. It's a hypocritical religion. Well, why would they think that? It's because, as you will see here soon for yourself, for many of them, their experience with Christianity is that it's something you do at church, but it's not being lived beyond the church. It's something where you act one way, dress one way, behave one way, talk one way when you're at church. But then you get home and you live a completely different life there. Well, it's no wonder if that's what their experience is with it, that they don't end up walking away from it altogether when they get older. And yet they are still searching for what they call true spirituality. They're looking for something more. Well, let me be clear from the start. Christianity was never meant to be something we only do for 1 hour out of the week. Can I get a big amen to that? Christianity is meant to be a lifestyle that is lived, but many of them have not experienced it as that. And that is because we have an enemy. What is our enemy's name? Satan. And Satan is always at work to prevent Christianity from advancing. And Satan knows, though, that in God's word, it says that Satan will not prevail against the church. How may I say amen to that? I mean, that is good news. We know he's not going to defeat the church, and he knows that as well. And so he, instead of attacking the church, I believe that he has made, because there is no such promise regarding the home. And I believe Satan has made the home his primary target and has been working there for many generations now, because he realizes that if he can get Christ and Christ-like living out of the home, he can cause all sorts of problems for Christianity. He can cause all problems for marriages. He can cause all sorts of problems for the future generations being raised in these environments. And to be honest, Satan has been winning the battle for what's happening in homes today. That is our bad news. But there is good news today. And the good news is that we serve a great God. Can I get a big amen to that as well? And it's not like God is sitting up there in heaven going, oh no, what am I going to do about this? God has a solution, always has, always will, and God is on the move today. I think God is tired of one-hour Christianity. God is tired of seeing Satan win these battles in the home, and God is on the move to reclaim what's happening in home state. And this movement is this faith at home movement that he is leading, and this movement is rooted in his word. That's why you can know it's God's movement, because it comes right out of his word. It's an ancient truth. So if you will, turn with me to God's solution, which is found in Deuteronomy chapter 6. You don't have your Bibles, we'll put it up here on the screen for you. But as you're turning to Deuteronomy, fifth book of the Old Testament, so you find at the beginning of your Bible, the word Deuteronomy means, which is what I love about this movement, is the word Deuteronomy means repetition of the law. Repetition of the law. And if you read through the whole book of Deuteronomy, what you will see is Moses keeps repeating kind of the same things over and over again. You'll read a little bit, then you'll go a few chapters later, and you'll be like, I think I heard that before. Then you'll go a few more chapters, and you'll be like, I know I heard that before. And that's because Moses is speaking to a really stubborn group of people. God's chosen people, this Israelite nation, right? They're God's chosen people. They've been delivered from captivity. They've been through the Red Sea experience. They're on their way to the promised land. And now this is that period of time where God is saying, okay, now Moses, you now need to instruct them in how to live their life my way, to follow my commands, so that they will live that way when they get into the land that I have promised to them. So Moses gathers the people up and says, all right, everyone, I want to teach you what God's ways are. And everybody comes and they listen and they say, sounds good, we're going to do it. And then they walk away, they mumble, they grumble, they complain, they don't do it. So then he has to repeat it to them again. So they come back together and they're like, oh, okay, sounds good, we're going to do it. And then they mumble, grumble, they complain, they don't do it, and they walk away. So then he has to repeat it to them again. Does that sound familiar to anyone here in the room? Anyone here find yourself having to, anyone here stubborn? Now's not the time to nudge the person next to you, but you know, do we need a repetition of the law today? In fact, what I'm going to be sharing with you is the way it used to be. If you talk to anyone that comes from the silent generation, those born between the years of 1930 and 1945, if you were to ask them, how did you come to know God? How did you come to know God and his ways? Where were you taught that? What you will hear from that generation, they will say, I was taught that by my parents at home. That's how I learned it. That's how I learned to follow God. But then if you were to go ask baby boomers, you'll start to see, well, I was taught a little bit at home and a little bit at church. And then when you go to ask the baby busters, you'll hear that if I was mostly taught to me by church and what I kind of learned through Sunday school or through youth ministry there. And then if you go now to Generation X, most of them will say, well, mostly if anything, is certainly not at home, it was what I got from church and what I learned there, and now they're giving birth to millennial kids. Do we need a repetition of the law today? What I'm saying to you is it wasn't that long ago, but we have gotten away from it. And in fact, what I believe today is we don't have bad parents today, we don't have bad people today, but when it comes to knowing how to do faith at home, we have a bunch of people that have absolutely no clue what that looks like. Because most of our experiences is, in other words, if I were to ask you, where is the primary place where you go to connect with God? What most people will say is where? Church. That's not supposed to be the answer. What is supposed to be the answer? Well, let's take a look. We'll look at this journey together. Deuteronomy 6, verse 1. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God has directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you're crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. So right out of the chute, he's saying, okay, people, here's the deal. You can either live life God's way or not, but let me give you two good reasons why you would want to obey God's commands and live life his way. First reason is so that you, your children, and your children's children, meaning what we are talking about today, the decision that you make is how you're going to live your life or not, whether you're going to do life God's way or not, it's not only going to impact you, but it's going to impact your kids and grandkids. So bad news, you choose to be a fake, hypocritical Christian and not really live life God's way, it's not only going to impact you, but it'll probably lead your kids and grandkids to walk away from the faith. But there is good news. The good news is that we serve a God of second chances. How many say amen to that? And that's great news that we serve a God. So even if you've been a hypocrite up to this point, and maybe you've had some kids that have walked away from the faith, don't worry about it. God's grace covers that. And realize that if we choose today, the decision that you make today is not only going to impact you, but it's going to impact your kids and grandkids. So what we're talking about is going to have multi-generational impact. So this is bigger than just about you. But another good reason why you'd want to do life God's way is also so that you and your children and children's children may enjoy long life. Now let me ask you, friends here in Macedonia, who here wants to enjoy life? Okay, that was lame. I guess you guys, let me try that one again. And let me come at it from where he's coming at. He's saying enjoy long life, which in God's economy, that means eternal life. So let me ask you one more time, who here wants to enjoy eternal life? Where life is... Okay, we got a few more. We've got one. All right, let me try it one more time because I think you got more in you. Because I know what you get like when you're cheering for Duke or North Carolina, that you got a lot more North Carolina. No, you got one. So let me go one more step further. This isn't just about you, remember. This is about you, your kids, and grand. Who here does not want death to be the end for you, your children, and your children's children? All right, now I got your attention. And that's why I really feel that's what he does right here is he gets our attention, and the people are like, yes, I'm interested in that. Then that's why he says next, hear, O Israel. Hear, O people of Macedonia Church, and be careful to obey, so that life may go miserable for you. Is that what it says? No, so that life may go well with you. Who here likes the sounds of that? Who here would like life to go well? Please understand, though, that word does not mean easy. So he's not promising that life will go easy for you. Meaning, even when it's not easy, though, it can still be well. Who here likes the sounds of that? So this is so that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly. Meaning, not only does he want to help you be well today, but he wants to put you on a trajectory of increasing in wellness all the way on through death to our ultimate place of wellness, a place where there will be no pain, no suffering for you, your children, and children's children. Who here wants that? Anyone interested in that? If you're interested in that, then he says, all right, hear, O Israel. If you're interested in that, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your strength. These commands, that's it that I give you today, that's what needs to be on your hearts. And impress that on your kids. So do you want wellness all the way on through death to eternal life for you, your children, and children's children? If you want that, it's by recognizing there's only one way that will get you there, because there's only one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Can I now get a huge Baptist amen to that? And yet we live in a culture and a society that's trying to take that away from us. They're trying to say, you can't believe in just one God. You need to believe in multiple gods, or there's multiple ways to God. And you know what? And it's not politically correct to say there's only one true God. I don't care if it's not politically correct. It's just the truth. Jesus is the way, the truth, the life, period. Amen. Amen? And we have to be crystal clear on that. Oprah won't get you there, and neither will Dr. Phil. That Jesus is the way, the truth. There's only one can get you there. And it's also that you now need to recognize God's the only way, and also it's that you are called to live in a loving relationship with this one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So I have a huge question for you this morning. Do you want wellness through death to eternal life for you, your children, and children's children? Then my question is this. Are you in love with God? are you just doing church? And there's a huge difference. And I feel there are a lot of people today that are doing church that aren't in love with God. Doing church alone is not what's going to get you there. It's being in love with God. Or let me take it a step further. Are you living in such a way that those who know you best would say you are in love with God? Because how many of you here want your kids or grandkids, whether you have them yet or not, how many of you here want to love God so that death is not the end? Did you see what gets there? It says, love the Lord. Before it says anything about your kids, it says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength. So the point is, your kids are going to love who and what you love. So if you want to talk about where does this start, where do you start to impress this? It starts with you being in love with God. Now, I have to confess something to you. When I started in church ministry, I didn't really think it was about you being in love with God. I thought it was about me. When I started as a camp director. Then I went out of Bible camp ministry because my dad was a camp director. Then I went from camping ministry. Then God put me in a church, and I started out as a youth pastor in a church. Well, when my attitude pretty much was, I don't care about you. It's about me. Are you kidding me? I am the coolest youth pastor in the world. Just ask me. I really am. And I really thought I was. I mean, are you kidding me? I could lead games. I could lead them in Bible study. I could take them on retreats. I could play guitar, lead them in worship. I could do all that. So my attitude pretty much was, give me your kids. I'm cooler than you anyhow. Just let me have your kids. And, of course, most parents were like, you want my kids? Here you go. Good luck, right? And it was like this win-win situation. Our youth program was growing, so we were looking successful in God's eyes. You were getting free babysitting, and everything was going the way it's supposed to. Then we were asked to be a part of this silly survey called the Significant Religious Influences Survey. And our teenagers in our youth program took part in this survey. When we got the, and it was just a survey that's trying to identify what are the things that influence kids to have faith in Christ. Well, I was certain, are you kidding me? It's going to show me, the youth pastor, as the number one influence, because I'm leading him in games, I'm leading him in Bible study, I'm leading him in worship. Of course it's me. When we got the results, I was so confident that it was going to show me as the number one reason that I didn't open the results until I got to the youth committee meeting, because I wanted it to make the case for why I should get paid more than the senior pastor, you know? So I didn't even open the results because I knew it was going to show me. To my surprise, I get to youth committee meeting, give it to the chair of the youth committee, and they open the results. And let's look together at the results. The number one influence that leads kids to faith in Christ is mom. I was like, whoa, isn't that cute? But then I just kind of dismissed it, like, yeah, whatever. Everybody puts mom down first, you know. You always see the athlete, right? Hi, mom. It's always about mom. So I'm like, yeah, yay for mom. Good for her. But now, well, let's get to number two, which will be me. Number two was dad. It's like, what? How could dad possibly be more influential than me? Dad doesn't lead games. He doesn't lead worship. He doesn't even, I hardly even see dad. How could dad be more influential? And this one, just so you know, it does show dad is 20 points less than mom. That's not really accurate. Because they found out later, they had more kids that took this survey that had active moms and had active dads. When they re-looked at it, and at some more recent studies that have come out, showed dad to be just as high as mom. Sometimes, actually, dad becomes a little more influential than mom. So they just put moms and dads right at that same level, around 80%. Then, the next one is pastor. Do you notice it does not say youth pastor? Oh, yeah, I had a huge problem with that. I'm like, are you kidding me? That Greg guy? How could he possibly be more? You know, well, then I became one of those, so I can't say more. Number four, grandparent. Which, by the way, if you're a grandparent in the room, please let this sink in. You are the most influential person here when it comes on passing on faith. Because think about it. You're still mom, and you're still dad, and you're a grandparent. You have all that influence. And yet what I am finding today is Satan is working overtime to try to get grandparents out of the game. And he's using either guilt or fear to do it, saying you didn't do it right when you had a chance, so you have no reason to try to do it now, or you don't know how to text or Facebook post, so you don't know how to do it right anyway, so don't even try. Those are all lies from Satan. In fact, that's why we're doing a grandparent seminar this afternoon at 4, which is just to talk to you about ways that you can continue to be an influence in the life of your adult children and grandchildren, because, friends, there is no retirement plan on this one. Amen? And we need to keep you in that game. Now, then after grandparent, then come some of the church programs like Sunday school, and we will see things like youth group and church camp and retreats, which, by the way, do you also see what's not on the list yet? Yeah, youth pastor didn't show up till about next. Friends, let me be clear. How many of you here want your kids to have faith in Christ so that death is not the end? This is when I had my Saul to Paul moment. Mom and dad, and what you do is 2 to 3 times more influential than any church program. Did you hear that? Mom and dad, and what you do is 2 to 3 times more influential than any church program. Or let me put it this way. If you want them to have faith in Christ so that death is not the end, would you like an 80% chance at that or a 25% chance? Because if you drop them off in church programs and expect our programs to do it for you, our programs only have about a 25% chance of working. Of course, we don't advertise that in the brochures. Or I like this math better. If you do it in the home and you have them in church programs, that's 80 plus 25. Who here likes the sounds of that math? And that's what God intended all along. But where do we need to put 80% of our energy? Into helping you do it at home. And now I know some of you are sitting there going, well, thanks a lot, Pastor Mark. Now you dumped it on us. What are we supposed to do? Deuteronomy 6 tells us. Let's take the next step. Now that you understand it's about you living in love with God. Now, out of that love that you have for God and His ways, now impress this on your children. How? By you talking about the ways of God with your kids when you sit at home. So I'm not making this up. This is God's design. This is God's plan. When you sit at home with them, when you walk along the road, or in today's context, when you're driving, talk about God and His ways with your kids at bedtime with them. Talk about God and His ways with your kids in the morning. Tie it as symbols on your hands. Bind it on your foreheads, which means you continue to wear the ways of God with you wherever you go. In other words, you never check out of being a Christian. You continue to live life God's way at work and wherever you go. Amen? And then also, write it on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. The picture in Scripture is crystal clear that the home has always meant to be the primary place where faith is to be lived, where faith is to be nurtured, and where faith is to be talked about. So when people ask, where do you go to connect with God? The answer should be home. I do it at home. And also the church helps me, but my home's my primary place. And yet for many, that's not what it looks like. In fact, I want to show you what's happening in homes today. In fact, let's have some fun with this. I want you to get a partner, and let's get ready to enter into a little bit of a friendly competition, okay? So get a partner that you're going to compete with, and you're going to try to guess these next statistics. And whoever does a better job guessing, the other one has to buy them lunch when we're done, okay? So we kind of just can take care of that right now. So realize these are so this is going to get serious now. Realize these are churched kids that are asked these questions. So kids are active in the church, so that may skew your answers that way. What do you think is the percentage of church-going kids who would view their mom as someone they consider to be very religious? That they would say, yep, I've got a mom who loves God with her heart, soul, and strength. What do you think that is? Go ahead and say it to your neighbor. Percentage of church kids who view their mom as being very religious. I got a godly mom. What do you think that is? The answer is 48%. How many of you were too high? Let me see that. How many of you were too high? How many of you were too low? There's our cynics in the crowd. We've got a few over here and a few, so I know where you're at. What is the percentage of church-going kids? What is the percentage of church-going kids who view their dad as very religious? What do you think that is? View their dad as very religious. I got a dad who loves God with his heart, soul, and strength. The answer is 23%. That was quite the reaction. What is the percentage of church-going kids who have experienced some sort of prayer, some sort of Bible reading, or some sort of devotions in the home? And all they had to do is experience it once. Have you experienced one of these three things in your home? What do you think that is? Just experienced them. Answer is 27. Actually, it does get worse. If you take mealtime prayer away as an option, it drops down to less than 10%. Less than 10. What is the percentage of church-going kids who have experienced a family service project? Because we're called to serve in Christ's name. That's what it means to be Christ followers. So how many have experienced that? The answer is 29%. And then finally, what is the percentage of church kids who have simply talked with their mom about faith? It doesn't say on a regular basis. It just says, have you talked to your mom about faith? What do you think that is? The answer is 28%. What's the percentage that have talked to their dad about faith? Talk to dad about faith. 13. So friends, with these statistics in full view, listen again. Impress the ways of God on your kids by talking about it with them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. Do we need a repetition of the law today, friends? How many of us would agree with this? Something with Christianity in America is not going as well as it should today. Yep, I think we all recognize that. But have you noticed, for the last 30 to 40 years, as Christianity has slowly been declining, have you noticed where we've had our attention? We've been working for 30 to 40 years to make church better, to make what we do at church better. If we just have better facilities, if we just have a better children's program, if we just had a better youth pastor with more tattoos, that would do it. If we just had a better men's program or women's program. And at the same time that Christianity has been declining, there are two religions in America that have been growing, Islam and Mormonism. If you were to compare us and were to ask, who does children's ministry better? Christianity would win. Who does youth ministry better? Christianity. Who does men's and women's ministry better? Christianity. Who has better facilities? Christianity. So we're winning in all these categories. But we're declining and they're growing. Guess what is the one category that they're better than us at? What they're doing at home. They're a religion that is based around that once you come into that religion, it is taught as a lifestyle you live, and you pass on that lifestyle to your, you teach that lifestyle to your children where? At home. Friends, do we need a repetition of the law today? And I want to be clear. I think the problem with Christianity today has far less to do with how we're doing church and much more to do with what's not happening in our homes. How many of you were alarmed by these statistics? A little bit surprised. That sets up this. How did this happen? Well, look at this. Let's continue our journey in Deuteronomy 6. We were warned specifically about this. Because right after Moses just gets done telling us, make sure that you live in love with God and then you pass it on to your kids and children's children in your home. You do that yourselves out of your home. He then says this, now, when the Lord your God brings you into the land that he's promised to you, to your forefathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to give you, it's going to be this land with large flourishing cities you didn't even build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you didn't provide, wells you did not dig, vineyards and olive groves you did not plant. Even when you eat, you're going to be satisfied. Let me stop there for a minute. Does that sound familiar to anyone here in the room? Show me by raising your hands. Who here lives in a city you didn't build? Who here lives in a house, apartment, or condo you didn't build? Who here drinks water from a well you didn't dig? Who here has a bunch of stuff in your house you have absolutely no idea where it came from? Two hands. Who here has plenty to eat when you need it? See, he was preparing them to enter a land of plenty. Who here lives in a land of plenty? We all do. What's your point, Moses? Look at verse 12. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord. You don't forget these things that we just got done talking about. Because here's going to be the danger. When you go into the land of plenty, there's going to be plenty to do, plenty to have, plenty to see, plenty to become. And when there's, since there's more to do, you're going to start doing more. There's more to have, you're going to start having more. There's going to be more to see, you're going to start seeing more and doing more and having more and becoming more and seeing more and doing more and having more. And the danger is as you start doing that, the danger is you can slowly start to forget God in these ways. You can forget to live your life this way because as you get busier, you start to not have time for some of the things that you used to have time for. So I'm so busy that I don't have time to fix a meal this afternoon, so we're going to swing through a restaurant and let them fix it for me. And you look at our society, and it's got lots of options that will fix the meal for me. So, okay, I'll take advantage of that. Oh, I don't have time to deep clean the house, so I'll find a cleaner that can come in once a month, and they can do that. I don't have time to teach my kids soccer, so I'll find a good soccer program and put them in that. I don't have time to read the Bible and figure it out for myself, so you know what? I'll find a pastor that hopefully will teach it to me, and he'll teach it well, and it better be deep, and it better feed me, show me, it better be funny, and make me laugh, make me cry, feed me. And that always used to drive me crazy, too, as a pastor, when people be like, I'm looking for a church where I can get fed, and I'm needing to be fed, and I really hope, we're leaving, because we're not just not getting fed here, and I'm looking for a place, because at that point, I'd literally like to pick up my Bible, and I'd like to start slapping up alongside the head, and be like, excuse me, why are you needing me to feed you? You should be full before you ever get to me. Feed yourself. You see why I didn't last long as a senior pastor? You know, I just didn't go over well. But friends, Why are we needing to be fed? We should be full before we ever get here. Amen? Or did we forget? Did we get too busy? Did we get too caught up? Our kids should already be being taught the Word of God at home and by their moms and their dads, and should already be in love with God. Or did we forget? Be careful, people, that you don't forget. And in case I haven't offended everyone here yet, I want to make sure I do before I leave. I think that warning is also for the church. Be careful, church, that you don't forget these things. Because the church can also get caught up in the trappings of do more, have more, become more. If we just get some more programs going here at church, then that'll get us some more people here. And once we have more people here, then we can build a bigger place. And now that we've got a bigger place, well, woohoo, we can do some more programs. That'll bring us in some more people, and then we'll make a bigger place. And woohoo, now we've got a bigger place. Programs, people, place. Woo! Programs, people, place. Woo! I was there, done that. I would actually argue that we now live in a time where we have the greatest programs that have ever existed in the history of Christendom. And we have some amazing places. And yet 60 to 90% of our kids are walking away from the faith, and Christianity is declining. Be careful, church, that you don't forget that at the end of the day, what happens in a home is more important than anything we do. And I have good news for you today, is you are sitting in a church that has drawn a line in the sand and has said, we are not going to forget that. We are going to be a faith at home focused church, where every ministry of this church is going to be about helping you be a Christ follower where? At home. We're going to have a men's ministry here. It's going to help you be godly men where? At home. A women's ministry is going to help you be godly women where? A children's ministry, it's going to help you pray and read the Bible with your kids where? A youth ministry, it's going to help you have faith conversations with your teenagers at home. Yes, a seniors ministry that's going to help you be meddling grandparents in the lives of your kids and grandkids. And that's why we're doing the parenting seminar and the grandparenting seminars. We're going to be giving you all sorts of tools so that you can know how to do it at home. How many say praise God for a faith at home focused church? So what does that look like then? Well, here's what it will look like as we commit to that. Look at verse 20 in Deuteronomy 6. It paints us a picture of our future. It says, then in the future, when your sons or when your daughters, when the next generation comes to us and says, what are the meanings, stipulations, decrees, the laws the Lord our God has commanded us? What does it mean to be a Christian? What are God's ways? What would God want me to do in this situation? What's it say next? Does it say take them to church and hope church will explain it? It says, no, you tell them. That's our future. You're going to be telling them. You tell them we were once slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out. You tell them the God story. So does that mean we don't need the church? No, we desperately need the church. But the role of the church is not to be a replacement that does it for us. The role of the church is to be a lifelong partner that helps us know the story. So if you don't know who God is and what he's done for you, we would love to help you know who the God of the universe is. We'd love to help you know the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We'd love to make sure you know who God is. And then, now that you know this, we're now going to help you tell the God story to your 3-year-old, to your 9-year-old, to your 13-year-old, to your 23-year-old, to your 53-year-old. And then we are going to help you live the story, because you've been called to be a part of God's story. We're going to help you live it out in your own home. And I had a chance to serve in one of those churches, a very faith at home focused church. And this church changed me. And as I started serving there, I just started there. Our daughter was 3. And right out of the chute, they said, one of the things you need to go to is with your daughter, there's this take it home event you have to go to, which your church is going to be doing these as well. And so my wife and I show up, and we're in this room with parents and their 3-year-olds. So you know what that's like. It's just chaos, you know? And then they'd start the event out with a puppet show, which it was funny, but it also made our kids cry. But anyway, other than that, it was well intended. And then after the puppet show, then they take our 3-year-olds to the next room, and now it's just us as parents there. They bring in a guy by the name of Rolf. He's in his early 50s, and he said, hi, everyone. My daughter is already in college, but I just thought I'd share with you our story. That from the day that she was born, we decided that every night we would pray a blessing over her. And the blessing we chose is from Numbers 6:24. Some of you are going to want to write that down. Numbers 6:24, the priestly blessing called, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. We love you. Amen. Numbers 6:24. He said, we prayed that blessing over her every night. She grew into a 10-year-old. We were still in her room. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you in favor and give you peace. We love you. Amen. Said she grew into a teenager. And he's like, now I must confess, we debated stopping during the teenage years. But he's like, we just decided we'd press on. So he said, but sometimes we'd wait till she was already asleep. It was a little safer to try it then. And we'd go into her bedroom and we would just simply say, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Demon, come out of her. Kidding. Although some of you are going to use that. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. We love you. Amen. He said, then came the day we had to take her to college. He said, that was not an easy day. And we packed everything up in the minivan. We took her to school, and we unpacked, got her dorm room set up. And he said, then I grabbed my wife by the hand, and that was it. We were not looking back. He said, we walked out of there, and we were down the steps and across the parking lot. And he's like, the minivan was right there in sight. When all of a sudden, we hear in the background, Mom, Dad, wait. Mom, Dad, wait. So we turned, and there came our daughter running to us. She's like, you guys can't go yet. You forgot to bless me. And Rolf said, I just couldn't believe it. He said, because there in the middle of that crowded college campus parking lot, we huddled up together and we laid hands on our daughter again as we had done since she was this big. Simply said, oh, sweetie, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace as you begin this next step in your journey. We love you so much. Amen. He then looked at us and just said, you know, they grow up fast. At that point, the timing was impeccable because now the doors opened and in came our unsuspecting 3-year-olds. It was now a race between my wife and I. And I was like, get behind me, honey. And I'm like, come here. You know, and I was looking for her and I found her. And I'm like, come here, honey. And she's like, what's wrong, Dad? I'm like, never mind. Just let me do this. Come here. And I grabbed her and I just instantly, I wasn't wasting. I was like, all right, here we go. I got to do this. She's like, well, what? Just let me do this to you. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep something in you, around you, through. May the Lord look somewhere near you. May the Lord just do whatever that guy said. And let's just say my first blessing was not good. But thankfully, they gave us the book, The Family Blessing, that Rolf had written, and every day since. Every day since. Now my daughter's in college. And the text that I get from her whenever I travel, which is pretty frequently, she will send me this text, Dad, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord continue to look upon you and give you peace on this next trip. Love you, Dad. Friends, that's it. Do you see our future? Do you see it? A Faith at Home church that didn't do it for me, but showed me how. And then I went home, and we lived that story. We told it, we lived it in our home. And now do you also see the multi-generational impact? My daughter is now growing up with that as normal. It's on her heart. Tell me she won't be blessing our grandkids when she gets to that point. That's our future. But in order for that to happen, we have to make a choice. So I'm going to invite the worship team up, and I've asked them to prepare a specific song for right now, because here's the deal. The church is not a building. The church is not a program. The church is not a pastor. The church is a people. And if this is going to be a Faith at Home focused church, that means you have to make a choice to be that as a people. Joshua stood before the people. He reminded them of all these things that had happened. And then it says this, he just simply said, now you guys have to choose this day who you're going to serve. The gods of this world are the one true God who wants to go well with you and wants to increase you and lead you all the way through death to eternal life. You got to choose this day. And then he said this, as for me and my household, we've made our choice. And all I'm telling you is, as for Mark, Maria, and Malin Holman, we've made our choice. But you have to choose this day. So I'm going to invite you right now that do you want to be a Faith at Home focused individual? Do you want to be someone that truly lives this in your home? Do you want to do this as a couple if you're married? Do you want to be a Faith at Home focused grandparent? Do you want to be a Faith at Home focused teenager that says, I'm not going to be just a 1-hour consumer of church. I'm going to actually live in love with my God and live it out in my home and establish my home as the primary place. If you want to do that today, as a person, as a teen, as an individual, as a couple, as a family, would you please stand? Would you make that choice right now? So that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly. Now this church has no choice because you are the church. And now God's going to use you as a church. Because as you become a Faith at Home church, there are many churches out there that have not made this commitment. And they need to see churches that have. So I'm going to pray that God's going to use you as a model for others as well. But then Joshua did this. After the people chose like this, it says that he then had a rock placed under the oak near the holy place of the Lord. In other words, where they would come and gather for worship, he had this rock placed there. So imagine if I had a huge rock and just placed it right here. And it'd be like, why do you guys have a rock in the middle of your sanctuary, right in the front of that? And why are we putting a rock here? And Joshua said, here's why. Because now I want that rock to remind us, every time we look at it, of this commitment that we have made. And I want you to remind you every time not to be untrue to this commitment. So here is the deal. In your aisles, those of you that are sitting here, there are little bags of rocks. Would you please hand that down the aisle? I want everyone to get a rock here today. Please take a rock. And no, you can't use this to throw at me. This is your personal rock. And what I want you to do with this personal rock is think of somewhere that you are going to put it where you will always see it. For some of you, that may be a specific place where you get ready in the morning. It may be on your desk at work. It may be in your locker at school. It may be in your pocket. It may be in your purse. Put it somewhere where you will always see it. And that's so that it will be that. And then I also, when you get home, there's a homework assignment with today's message. I want you to go get a big rock. I don't know where you're going to get it from. Maybe the neighbor's house, but whatever. Go get a big rock, and I want you to put that big rock somewhere obnoxious in your home where you will always see it. A place, maybe in the middle of your kitchen table. And people will be like, why do you have a rock in the middle of your kitchen table? Why do you have a rock in your pocket? Why do you have a rock on your desk? Why do you have a rock in your locker? To which you will say, I will tell you why. That rock is a reminder to me that I have not been called to just be a one-hour fake Christian. It's a reminder to me that I've been called to be a person that lives in love with my rock, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and that I've been called to make my home, this home, a place where Jesus resides here with us. Amen? So as you make that commitment, so today the song is Today I Choose. So as you make these commitments, may the Lord now bless you and keep you. May the Lord continue to make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord continue to look upon you with favor and to give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and all God's people said, welcome to the Faith at Home movement. I consider it a privilege to consider you a church that we can point others to that's in this area serving this movement. God bless you.